Thank you. You may be seated. If you turn in your copy of God's Word to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, we are continuing our series in the book of Acts. We are focusing in this section in Acts chapter 12, 13, and 14, a little bit further than that, on the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of God, the power of the church. We talked about two Sundays ago about the power of and the priority of prayer in the early church, and we saw the evidence of God's power in the release of Peter from prison. Right, we saw God answering specifically the prayers of the people, and that God was incredibly at work, though Herod seemed to be in control. But yet then we talked about last Sunday about the power and the peril of pride, that pride is so dangerous it can cause such harm to the body, to ourselves. And so we see those things, that God's power then overcomes Herod's, where Herod thought he had it all, Herod was in charge, but the reality was he really wasn't. God has the last word. And so we see Herod's life taken from him because he took the glory that only God deserved. And God took Herod out of this world. We talk about power, that we would pray that we would desire to see that kind of God power in our lives and in their church, that we would see that kind of power flowing through us, the body of Christ, into a lost and a hurting and a dying world. As we pray, as we seek Him, as we desire to see those miracles of transformation occur right before our very eyes. Talk about power. We'll do that this Sunday, and then we're going to lay aside Acts again to the 1st of May, and we're going to do a second in our series on this Vision 2020, the vision frame we believe that God has given us. We talked about back in January about our map. We're going to talk about in 6 Sundays together about the motives behind the mission. The motives behind the mission, there are 6 of those. And we'll talk about those in the coming Sundays. We're so excited about that. They really, really put the fire behind why we believe that engaging people with the hope of the gospel to see lives transformed is our mission. And there's values that go along with that. We call them our motives, but values be the interchangeable word. Those things that we say we really, really value. And we say some of those we value, some of those we want to value. We're not quite there yet as our vision team has looked at these 6 and said, well, where are we and where do we need to be and how do we go about getting there? And by the way, I'd ask you to pray about that Vision 2020. We're bringing that consultant in to finish up this last piece of our vision frame called Vision Proper. There's a group of about 15 or 16 folks that will spend all day Saturday, March the 25th, and all day Sunday afternoon, March the 26th, finishing up this piece and asking God, what is your preferred picture of the future for Petal First Baptist? Along with this vision frame that we believe God has given us, then this vision proper that says, this is where we're going and this is how we're going to get there. I would ask you to be praying about that even now. But we go back now, though, to the church at Antioch in Acts chapter 13, and we see the launching of the first missionary journey of Paul and Barnabas, the beginning of the gospel going to the ends of the earth, this church that is in the middle of great darkness in the city of Antioch. We see it being a great light. And now is about to send that light out into the rest of the world. And we see here the focus in chapter 13. We're going to talk about the power and the pursuit of purpose, both for the church as a whole and for our church as a whole, but also for us as individuals. And even the message that Paul brings to Antioch, a different Antioch, not the one of Syria, but a different Antioch, he brings this message of the gospel. But intertwined in that, we find some incredible statements of purpose for our lives right here today. We'll get there in May. We were going to do part 1 this morning of this message. But before we get there, I want to talk about this first point that we'll focus a bit more about the purpose of the church that impacts you and me and some important things, critical things for our church that I believe should challenge us, that should also confirm some things that we are doing, and maybe some things we'd say, Lord, maybe we're not quite where we need to be. But in Acts chapter 13, beginning in verse number 1, let's read here through verse number 13. Now there were at Antioch, in the church, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas and Simeon, who was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Then when they had fasted and prayed, twice in 2 verses, they talk about fasting and praying. Don't miss the emphasis there. Verse 3, then when they had heard fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and they sent them away. So, being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia. From there, they sailed to Cyprus. And when they had reached Salamis, they began to proclaim the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they also had John as their helper. John Mark, this is the guy named John Mark. John Mark was more than likely, we believe, most scholars believe, was the guy who wrote the book of Mark. Peter had discipled John Mark, and Peter had told this story of John Mark, which is how John wrote the gospel of Mark, by the way. So don't miss that, and we'll come back and grab that truth in a moment. And verse number 6, and when they had gone through the whole island as far as Paphos, they found a certain magician, a Jewish false prophet, whose name was Bar-Jesus, who was with the proconsul, Sergius Paulus, a man of intelligence. This man summoned Barnabas and Saul and sought to hear the word of God. But Elymas, this is the same guy, Bar-Jesus, the magician, for thus his name is translated, was opposing them, seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith. But Saul, who was also known as Paul. Now we'll see this transition happen here. Paul is Roman name. Saul is Jewish name. We'll be referred to as Paul throughout the rest of the book of Acts. Filled with the Holy Spirit, fixed his gaze upon him and said, "You who are full of all deceit and fraud, you son of the devil." Woo! Don't you know that got some applause? Well, that made him a popular guy, didn't it? When's the last time you heard a pastor stand up in the pulpit and call somebody a son of the devil? It's going to be quiet in here this morning, so you have to help me out a little bit, right? Not very often, right? That's not a real popular statement to make to somebody, but Paul mentions no words here. "You are an enemy of all righteousness. Will you not cease to make the crooked the straight ways of the Lord?" What a statement. "And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you will be blind and not see the sun for a time." And immediately a mist and a darkness fell upon him, and he went about seeking those who would lead him by the hand. Now, before I read verse 12 and 13, just stop in a minute. Can you think of somebody else that was blinded by a mist and darkness and had to be led around? Can you think of somebody who had that happen to them? Saul. Wow, what an interesting, ironic moment. That God uses Saul to bring a sense of discipline on Bar-Jesus, a sense of punishment, to try to get Bar-Jesus' attention in the same way that it got Saul's attention. Verse number 12, notice, "Then the proconsul believed when he saw what had happened, being amazed at the teaching of the Lord." Now, Paul and his companions put out to sea from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia, and John left them and returned to Jerusalem. Wow, some powerful things here that are happening in this scripture, some incredible moments that we rejoice about. Before we get to those in the story, once they get to Cyprus, let's back up and spend some time here in this first couple of verses here. And I want you to know this first piece here on your outline. It says this: we are to call out the called. We are to call out the called. Now, let us be clear from the very beginning what I mean by this statement. Now, I think all of us understand this, but let me make it very clear so that you understand it, that the church really doesn't call out anyone, right? It is God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, who calls out people. I'll give an example in my own life. I began as an eighth grade boy. I was telling my story to another pastor in Baton Rouge when I'd done the funeral with this last week of Rebecca's grandfather. And we were talking and he said, "Well, tell me, where did you grow up in church?" And so I was telling him about the church I grew up in. And at First Baptist Church in Jackson, I remember there one summer, I think it was my eighth grade year, the summer between my eighth and ninth grade year, our pastor had returned. He had been gone for about 6 years, but he returned back us for his second tenure there at our church. And we had been going through some difficult times. We were building a new building. And so anyway, I got to spend a whole summer, this sounds pretty amazing to you, but I got to spend a whole summer helping catalog his cassette tapes. Now, for those of you who are under the age of 20, a cassette tape is this little thing that has two little spinny things in it, right? And you put it in a player. Some of y'all have never seen a cassette tape probably in your entire life. Some of you have seen 8-tracks, so you know you go even further back than that. But a cassette tape you didn't have. So you had all these sermons. So I spent a whole summer in his office helping sort and label along with the pastor secretary. And so I got to spend a whole lot of time with the folks in the church. And it was there that God began to birth a love for me of the church. And it was in those moments I traced back there in the eighth grade where God began to speak clearly to my heart that I knew that God had called me. That was about 2.5 years later before I really began to understand that call. But the summer of my 10th grade year, between my 10th and 11th grade year, in June of 1988, at Friends Forever, part number 2, that great song and a great camp theme for every camp back in that decade of the 80s, friends are friends forever, if the Lord's the Lord of them, right? We went to that camp, it was in Orlando, Florida, Dave Busby was speaking, Wayne Watson was singing, I was there in a very freezing cold auditorium, I can remember where I was seated in that seat, where God completely confirmed, spoke to my heart, I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that God called me. God had called me to be a youth minister first, but I also knew that God at some point had called me to be a pastor. I knew it. There was no doubt in my mind. And it wasn't anybody else looking at me and said, Brad, you should be a youth minister. Brad, First Baptist Jackson has decided that you should be a pastor. They probably thought the opposite to start with when they looked at me in the 10th grade probably. But yet, I got an opportunity to come home from that camp that Saturday night. I got to come home and that late that Saturday night, and I knew it. And my dad, we had talked about it for a while, and my dad didn't think I was ready yet, and so we had talked about it. And so I was so nervous to tell my dad because I didn't know how my dad was going to react, but I was so convinced that even though I feared my dad righteously, and I feared my dad in a good way, right? I mean, I revered my father. I didn't want to do anything against him, right? But I was so convinced, if even my dad had told me no, I knew that it's what I needed to do to make it public before my church. And I remember going before my dad and going, Dad, I need to tell you something. All right? We're sitting in his back bedroom where you had those serious conversations into my house. We went to his bedroom. We sat on the bed there. And I began to tell him what happened. And because I kept asking him, Dad, how will I know for sure if I'm called? And how will I know? And he said, Son, you'll just know. And I'm like, but Dad, that just sounds really dumb. I mean, how do you just know? He said, you'll just know. You'll just know. And so I said, Dad, I know. And I began to tell him, and kind of trying to rationalize, I said, Dad, I'm going to go down front, and I watched the tears begin to, I only saw my dad cry twice in my whole life. And I saw tears begin to roll down his cheeks. We prayed together there. I knew that God had called me. Now, what was the church's part? To call out the called. To recognize that call, to affirm that call, to encourage that call, to affirm meaning that we see that, we recognize that call that we believe God is also, we believe, has placed upon your life. Now, in this sense of what happening with Saul and Barnabas, or Paul and Barnabas here, we see that it is a call that was found by seeking the Lord, right? And the church recognized that. It wasn't the church looked up and said, hey, we need to send you guys as missionaries. God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, somehow worked in the hearts and lives of Paul and Barnabas, as well as the church, to say, yes, this needs to happen. So I would say this on the very front side, and we'll talk this in a moment, but God calls out those to full-time Christian service. And part of our vision 2020, we've talked about it, and we're still talking about it, praying and believing that God is going to call somebody out of this body of believers. This will make some of you really nervous and start to squirm, but that's fine. That God is going to call somebody out of this body of believers to go to the foreign mission field. Permanently, right? To go there. We've prayed specifically that it would be in our people group, the Sangha Sakadao. That's what we've prayed that God would do. But we believe that God will call out the called. And our church wants to be a part of that. For those that God has called to be in ministry, to be pastors and youth ministers and missionaries, whatever it is God calls you, that you're listening now, students, to what God might call you to do. You're listening now, adults. Well, you're saying, I've already got my career. I've already got this and that and the other. Hey, listen, God doesn't have the same timetable we do. I went to seminary with tons of folks that were 30 and 40 years old who God called late in life, who they had a call earlier, but they missed it. Or maybe God they did what God called them to do, but at 40, God radically changed the direction. So we're called as a church body to call out the called and send them to the ends of the earth and even right here in our own backyard, right? And that's kind of this whole overarching purpose. But before we dive deeper into that point, let me give you a couple of thoughts about the early church here in Antioch. First of all, we notice about the church, and this is very important, part of their DNA, they were a church with very strong leadership. They were a church with very strong leadership. These points are not up there. You can write them down there if you want to. But they were a church with very strong leadership. The Bible says here there were prophets and teachers We see two guys in particular that had already been leading this church for quite some time. Barnabas, who was a wealthy Jewish man from Cyprus who had been living in Jerusalem, who the church from Jerusalem had sent him to Antioch to check out what was going on. He was so excited, he stayed there, and God used him for a season. Then he goes and grabs Paul, brings him from Tarsus. Saul, being this guy who was a rabbi, he was the rabbi of the rabbis. And he had been to school under Gamaliel. I mean, this guy was as Jew as you could possibly get from the tribe of Benjamin, but he also had a Roman citizenship. All right, there were some other men who were leading the church as well. We'll look at it in a moment. And even other leaders that were not mentioned here in Scripture. There was a strong leadership here in the early church. And it is so important, let us not ever forget that leadership is crucial in any avenue of life. But in particular, the church, that men and women take up their God-given call and roles in the church to lead the body. It is true, everything rises and falls on leadership. It's really, really true. And I'll never forget talking to people early on in this process. Dr. Dan Caldwell, when we were talking about the First Baptist, when I was praying about coming, and here's what he said. This is such a great statement about this body of believers that was here back in 2012. He said, this is a body of believers ready to get on mission with the Lord. They just need some leadership to lead them forward. And I thought, well, I'm not sure that's really me, but okay, we'll pray about that. And God used the leaders that were already here, coming alongside your pastor and the church leaders of our church to see us go forward and for God to begin to do some extraordinary, wonderful, and exciting things. There's an incredible call that's placed on our lives as leaders to serve by leading others. So the question would ask us as a leader, what kind of leader are you? What kind of leader are you becoming? How are we leading? And the most important question, how are we following our leader who is the head of our church, Jesus Christ? You see, leadership is critical. They had it in the early church. The second thing they had, not only was great leadership, but that's so important. The second thing was there was a great bit of diversity. There's a lot of diversity in this early church, which perhaps might be surprising to us, but not to the Lord. Living in a city of Antioch that was incredibly diverse. Josh talks about living in Vancouver, Canada. All kinds of ethnicities, nationalities living in the city of Vancouver. But even right here in good old Petal, Mississippi, there are 8 or 9 different languages spoken right here in our own school district. A small microcosm of a much larger picture. There's not a lot of those students, but there is a fair number of students right here, even in Petal, Mississippi. Our world has changed dramatically when I was a kid. Some of you that grew up even more so, that the world has come to us in greater numbers than in history. How do you know it's diverse, preacher? Well, let's talk about a couple of guys that are mentioned here in Scripture. Some more of these leaders that are mentioned here. First was Simeon, called Niger. This word Niger meant either dark-complected or black, leading many to believe, scholars to believe, he was of African descent. Some commentators even believe, and depending on which one you read or not, you find that that some believe this was the same Simeon, right, that carried the cross of Jesus. I don't know if it's true or not, but there certainly is a possibility that was the case. There was also Lucius from Cyrene, which was in North Africa. Then you have this guy, Manaen, who is a foster brother of Herod Antipas. He was brought up alongside of him in the palace. So here was a guy of the upper crust, the high society, if you will, who was a part of the leadership of this early church. So then you add in Paul and Barnabas. You have 5 guys who are very distinct, very different, who are leading a very diverse church. So there we see in the early church from the very beginning, God's desire, God's plan is for the church to be different and diverse, to not look the same. Right? Now, let's just for a moment, and it won't take you very long, just look around our body. Take a look around. Let's kind of like turn your head left and right just a minute. Make sure some of you are already asleep already. We all look pretty similar, don't we? Yeah, we do. Now, some of us, we are different, and we'll talk about those differences, but by and large, from a racial standpoint, we are pretty similar. Yet, I think one of the growing desires of our church, one of the things that God has birthed inside of us, I think and pray, is that our church would look different, right? One of the things we've partnered with Mount Vernon was a desire to move that direction. We want to see our church become more diverse, and that has to happen with intentionality, right? We want to be more diverse, more different. Now, we are diverse and different in a lot of ways, but that one way we're not, and I believe that God would have us to be that way, right? Now, we don't force it. We don't go out and make it happen per se, but we open our minds and our hearts and begin to seek those people out that God would have to be a part of this body. Then we become aware of our surroundings, right? And so all this past week, we've had some guys, Hispanic guys, on our roof, roofing our building, right? On a really high roof. Oh, man, they just run around like this, like they're on a 10-foot roof. I'm just up here, my feet start sweating when I look at them up on that roof thinking, oh, it'll fall off. Well, tomorrow, we're going to feed those guys lunch. Now, I don't speak Spanish. I was in Spanish for 10 weeks at Baylor University. My professor, Ernest Elwood Norton, that was his name. I still remember his name. He called me up one afternoon. He said, Brad, I need to do you a favor. You need to drop my class. You are terrible in Spanish. You're going to fail my class if you don't drop it. I'm like, yes, Captain Obvious, I'm well aware. I already know I'm going to fail. I cannot speak Spanish. I'm terrible at it, right? So we've got a pastor in Hattiesburg who speaks fluent Spanish who's going to come, and we're going to share the gospel with him, give them a, we got how God works. In the tornado, somebody brought us like 20 Hispanic Bibles. Why did God bring us those? Because God knew we're going to have 15 Hispanic roofers on our building, some of which may be believers already. I have no idea. I can't speak Spanish. I don't know. But their lead guy, Sergio, speaks English, and so we've talked to him. So we're going to feed them a free lunch on Monday, right? And then they're going to take a siesta. No kidding, they do every day. Every day they take a siesta. They take a little break in the hour, take a little break, and they get back to work. Hardworking guys, they work really hard. We just want to say thank you to these guys to help our roof not leak anymore and share the gospel and give them a Bible, right? We've got to be aware of what's around us, right? We want to be diverse and different in the way that God would call us to be. This church was diverse. Not only diverse in the sense of diversity, we're also united together in one heart and one spirit and one mind. I pray and I believe that we are, that we're on that same page together, united in heart and spirit, aiming towards that mission of which God has for Petal First Baptist Church. Notice the second thing. Not only there was strong leadership, there was a church that was diverse. The third thing we see here is there was a church who prayed and fasted. Now, sometimes we as pastors, when we do a sermon, I'm like, well, I just preached on praying 2 weeks ago, and so there's a temptation just to kind of jump over this again, right? But if we don't, if we do that, we miss the intentionality of Scripture. And this is one of the reasons why I like to preach expositionally through Scripture, right? Because you have to work through the verses as they come, right? And so sometimes we might be tempted to skip over this, and we find a lot of times throughout the New Testament in particular, there's a lot of repetition. Right? Why is that? Because God knows them and us and those that will follow us are dull, thick-headed, we forget easily, and now in the day and age we live in, we are bombarded with so much information on a daily basis. 2 weeks ago, the vast majority of you couldn't tell me one point, and let me make you feel better, I'm not sure I could either from my sermon 2 weeks ago, right? So it doesn't hurt us to come back and talk about praying and fasting again. Now, I didn't mention fasting. It was only about praying what he talked about there with Peter. But I would have no doubt in that early church in Jerusalem, they were also fasting. Why is it that God moved in extraordinary, powerful ways in the life of the early church? Let me tell you one of the greatest secrets, but it's not very secretive, of the early church. Where did their power come from? Where did the move of God come from? Come in such an incredible fashion. Here's how it came. The people were committed to praying and fasting. And we have lost that in our churches today. And I don't mean about a prayer meeting where we do in 2 minutes and we God bless our prayer request, which we try not to do that, but sometimes that we get into that pattern and that rut, it happens. But we're a church that prays. One of the things, again, I mentioned, and I'm going to mention it to you again, our Vision 20 talked about one of the signs of a church that is being transformed is a church that is praying. Pray. There are people that pray all over the building, that pray at the altar during the invitation times. People that pray with others during an invitation time. People praying before the service and after the service. They see somebody and they know there's a need in their life and pull them off to the side and say, let me just pray for you right now. Praying people over the phone, praying for people constantly, praying that we'll have this prayer ministry we've talked about for a while that still is yet to come to fruition, but it's on my heart we would see happen that we have this prayer ministry where people could come and pray during our times of worship. And even individually, we pray in our homes with our families as individuals, and we would even fast for God to move. Here's the real question. We are a hungry people, right? It's 11:16. Some of you are already contemplating lunch. Where am I going for lunch today? Some of you are going to eat breakfast because you didn't get it. You're going to have to eat a kind of a breakfast brunch because you didn't wake up until 9:45. And so you're going to go get a breakfast and a lunch. You're already thinking, what am I going to do for lunch, right? We're hungry people. We're always, even in a day, right? We eat breakfast, we're thinking, what's for lunch? What's for supper? Why? Because we're hungry. Here's the question. What fasting is designed to do is to ask us this question. What are we hungry for? Are we more hungry for physical food than we are spiritual food? Are we more hungry for the things of the world than we're hungry for the things of God? And I'm preaching to myself, not just to you. There are seasons in our life when we are not as hungry for the things of God as we should be. So maybe a word of encouragement and challenge to us about the early church and seeing the power of God move in extraordinary ways. Just maybe we need to spend more time on our knees in prayer. Just maybe collectively in our life groups, we need to spend more concentrated time in prayer. And I mean focused prayer. And I don't want to knock any kind of prayer request, but praying for Aunt Sally's cousin's fourth removed brother-in-law's friend who has a wart on their toe might not be what I'm talking about. Okay? Not that there's anything wrong with praying for those kinds of things, but praying for lost people. Praying for God to move in our services. Praying for God to call people to be a part of the body of believers, to not be scattered to the ends of the earth, but to be focused on what matters the most. Praying for us on our mission, praying for God to send more laborers in the harvest, praying for God to move and protect your family and to see God move in your life. And even fasting during the week, skipping a meal, leaving something out of your life and spending that time in prayer. Maybe you cut out your hobby during the week for a while. Well, that'd be a humdinger for some of us. I'm going to cut out golf. That's 4 hours. Woo! That'd be a humdinger. I'm not going to watch a baseball game. I'm not going to go do this. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to spend that time I would have spent doing that, spending time in prayer and in Bible study and seeking God's face. You see, that's what they did in this early church. And here's what happens. The Bible says, as they were praying and fasting, what happens? God calls out Paul and Barnabas. So, if you don't want God to call you out, don't pray and fast. Is that what I'm saying? Well, not exactly, but you get the idea. We're called to pray and to fast and to seek God's face above all others. Notice these last two. They were a spirit-filled church. The Bible tells us here the Holy Spirit of God was moving, right? As they were ministering to the Lord, it says, the Holy Spirit said. So what does that mean? They were listening. Here's the great question. Are we listening for the Holy Spirit to speak to us as individuals? Are we listening for the Holy Spirit of God to speak to us as a body of believers? God, we stand ready for you to speak to us. That's what every invitation is for. That's what every time of worship is for us to communicate to a holy God, but also as we are worshiping him and praising him and adoring him, we're also putting our lives before him to say, Lord, I'm listening. I want to hear what you have to say to me, because when we get together, listen, God has something to say to every single one of us. The only issue is, are we listening? And then are we willing to respond to the Holy Spirit of God? Now, by the way, when we come to this building, we don't bottle up. When you leave this building a little bit, right, I'll be the last person out the door. I'm going to turn the lights off. I want you to know when I leave the building, I don't come in the building and sit in the front pew and say, by the way, Holy Spirit, goodbye. We'll see you Wednesday night. You enjoy hanging out here a while. We'll be back. Now, it's supposed to be funny. Y'all are really, really asleep. This is a preacher's favorite Sunday of the year to preach, I can tell you. Right? That's ridiculous. We know better than that, right? Why? Because where does the Holy Spirit of God live? He lives inside the hearts of believers, right? So we don't leave him here. We take him with us. So a spirit-filled church is not because the building is full of the Spirit of God. It's because the people of God who make up the church, who are the church, therefore it is a spirit-filled church. And so I love the days on Sundays when the people of God are full of the Spirit of God walking this building. And I'm just telling you, you can tell when that happens. You can tell when there's a sense of anticipation, a sense of asking God to move. I didn't just show up just because I'm supposed to. It's Sunday. It's 10:30. I need to do that. I showed up because I'm expecting God to move. I want God to move. I want to seek God's face. I want to be with the people of God. And that's when a place is called a Spirit-filled church. It's not spirit-filled because the music is great, though our music is great. It's not spirit-filled because we have a great building, and it is great. It is spirit-filled because the people of God are full of the Spirit of God. So we ask the question, what do people say about Petal First Baptist Church? I would hope they would say we are a praying church. I also would hope would say that we are a Spirit-filled church. When people walk in, they sense the presence of the Lord through you. Not the walls, not the carpet, not the chairs, not the instruments, not the person on the stage, but they sense it through you. I had somebody write me a text message a couple of weeks ago that they had come in one of the many churches that brought things to our building for us to hand out during the tornado. They wrote a beautiful text, so touching, and said this. I was so humbled by it. And they said, we came to your church, and he said, I sensed that you and your wife and this church were people where we sensed the presence of God and the Spirit of God. Wow. Man, there can be no greater compliment. They didn't know us. They were from, they were even from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, Jonathan. I mean, really. You know, I mean, I think they like the God, Ron, you know, so we would think they're a little bit loopy, but they're really not. I mean, they really got it, right? You know, what a powerful statement. Isn't that what we want people to know? That they would drive by this building and that the sense of what the Spirit of God does here, that they would be able to know this isn't the First Deposit Guarantee Bank of Petal. It's not savings and loans of Petal. This is First Baptist Church where the Spirit of God resides in its people. Who are the church? Who are Petal First Baptist Church? And notice this last one. We see there is incredible leadership. We see there is diversity, right? We see there's praying and fasting. We see there were a Spirit-filled church. And notice this last one. They sent out people from among them to go to the nations, right? I want you to notice something, and don't miss this. And we tried to do both these at the same time, and I think we've done it with some success, though we have a long way to go in so many ways, but I feel like we've come a long way from where we were. We were doing no missions in 2012 of anything to speak of. We were not really deeply impacting our city in any way, shape, form, or fashion. But I believe as you look backwards now to where we are today, I don't believe you could say that. Would you agree? Right? Look on this wall around you. Right? Some of you have come in this building so many times, you don't even pay attention to this wall. This wall wasn't because we needed to fill up space because it was all brown. Now it does look better and it's not all brown, right? But it tells the story, the evolving story, the continuing story of our call and our willingness to take up God's mission for us. But I want you to notice something. Before they send the first person out on a mission trip, right? Or to the mission field as missionaries. Notice they had spent years reaching their city. We cannot go, and we're not, but we must never be at a place where we're going to the ends of the earth, right? To Haiti, to Indonesia, to whatever other doors God might open for us if we're not doing it right here in our own backyard. If we're not willing to reach Muslims right here in our own backyard or those from those countries, and then go to the ends of the earth, and we are willing to do it over there, then we've got our priorities a little bit mixed up. It's the truth. Oh, that's a hard word. Ooh. Woo. Mission teams, that's a hard word, isn't it? Right? Now, does that mean we don't go? No, we still go, but that God would use both of those things here and there to challenge us to do both here and there. Right? We don't do one or the other, we do both. Right? But we are to send out people out of this body, right, who are listening for God's call. So here's the question. Are you listening for God's call? Could God be calling you to be a missionary? We don't say that statement often or even ask that statement very often, but it is the truth. God should be calling people out of this body to be missionaries and pastors, maybe professors in a seminary, maybe to be on a church staff somewhere, maybe working in a BSU in a college campus. Whatever it is God may be calling you to do. We got to be listening. And we as a church must be willing to help call out the called. The question is, will we answer and respond to God's call? Now, I want you to notice something quickly, too, just a brief sidelight. Notice the Bible says here that Paul and Barnabas are called out, but they also take along this guy named Mark. We know him as John Mark. His mother was very, very influential in the early church in Jerusalem. More than when Peter got out of prison, he goes to John Mark's mother's house. But they take along, the church sends out Paul and Barnabas, and then they take a journeyman, we might call him, in the I&B world. We might call him an apprentice, Josh, a church planning apprentice, or whatever those terminologies they use. What do? They take John Mark along with them to disciple them. I love when our life group material, the journey, dives beautifully right into what we're doing as a church, into the message. They took John Mark along to disciple him, to show him, to let him see how this was going to work out so that one day John Mark could do the same, which he would do later. That's our call, to take people alongside us. And this is a challenge because sometimes we just think to ourselves, leaders, and I am the worst. So I am the pot calling kettle black. I mean, I am on top of the list. I'm going to go get it done, so I just go do it. But our calling, our challenge to be is to take somebody along with us, right? To help do it alongside with us so they can see how to do it, so they in turn, when they could do it, which frees me up to go do something else or teach somebody else about something else, right? You get the idea. So there's discipleship happening, taking place in the middle of this mission trip. Pretty cool, isn't it? As we go through life, we're called to do those kinds of things. So it is our call as Petal First Baptist to recognize those who've been called, to equip them, to encourage them, to help them to get on mission with the Lord. That's why we have this Go Fund. We want to help people go. We want to help people go. As God builds His church here, we must continually call out the call. But we also must call out not only the called, because here's the other thing. Some of you are thinking to yourselves, goodness, thank goodness that point's not for me because God hasn't called me out. Oh, yes, He has. You are not exempt from the call of God. Now, your call may not be a full-time, right, a vocational call. But God has called all of us to full-time Christian service. We used to call it back when I was a kid. Right? Those who were called to full-time Christian service were those who were called to be a Christian 7 days a week and work in the church. That was the mentality, right? You hire the staff, they do the work, we show up, we help from time to time, right? That's never what God intended. God intended that the pastors, those that lead, to help equip and empower the body, to teach, to lead, to pray, to prepare, to send the body out to do the work of missions and evangelism and discipleship alongside with them. Right? So we see this picture here that God has called all of you, every single one of you sitting in this building. If you're part of this body of believers, then guess what? You're called to serve. If you're not, then when you do join, then God's called you to serve. If you're where you are in your church, you should be serving somewhere because every one of us, God has equipped you, God has prepared you, God has uniquely shaped you to go and serve right here in our church body or outside of the four walls in a ministry, whether it's here in Petal, whether it's in New Orleans, Louisiana, in St. Rose, whether it's going to be somewhere else in Mississippi, whether it's going to be to the ends of the earth, wherever it is, God has called every single one of us. Listen to me. Listen to my heart this morning. Lay it out to you with the choir on March the 12th, 2017. Listen to me. God has called every single one of us. None of us are exempt from the call to serve God. Thank you. Amen. I agree. It is true. Right? And we think, well, that's for somebody else. When I don't have kids, when I have more time, or when my job is this, or I have that. Folks, we'll make excuses until the cows come home. Right? The only issue is this. Where are you serving? And if you're not, then why not? And where can you serve? So maybe your question asked God this morning is, God, where do I need to serve? Now, some people talk about serving. They go, good night, serving. Huh. I don't want to serve. I mean, that's going to tie me down. I mean, the serving is, that sounds miserable to serve somebody, right? Man, can I just tell you, that's one of Satan's greatest lies. Boy, that would be one that Bar-Jesus, the magician, would have been talking about to Sergius Paulus. He would say to the church of the 21st century today, listen, serving God is difficult, it's hard, it's miserable, it's tough, it's difficult. It's so not true. Now, will it call you to sacrifice something? Yes, it should. Will it cause you some time and some money and some energy? It probably will. Will it cause you some headache on it? Would it be easier to come on a Wednesday night and not hang out with rambunctious, crazy, drive you crazy fourth and fifth grade boys? Yes. our kindergartners who ask 4,000 questions and who don't know what the word sit still means, right? Would it be easier? It would. It'd be easier to stay at the house, much less to come, right? But listen to me. What great joy when I baptized a little boy a few weeks ago, and here's what he said. Mr. Barry hurt my feelings, Barry, not the preacher. Not the preacher said. Mr. Barry said about baptism, and I don't remember the statement off the top of my head, but this, and this. So I did what any good preacher would do. I left where I was. I walked and interrupted his class and whispered in his ear, and I said, lest you ever think that those boys don't hear a word that you say. They're soaking it in like a sponge. And all of a sudden, you feel juiced up to go teach at least one more Sunday. Right, Barry? It's worth it. It's worth it to give a box to somebody in need. It's worth it to go sweat your guts out in a backyard kids club so those kids can find Christ and be baptized in this baptistry who otherwise might never step foot inside Petal First Baptist Church. You see, here is the robbing of the enemy of the joy of the body of Christ, and that is the call to serve and accept the call of God to go to the ends of the earth and right here in Petal, Mississippi. It is the greatest of all joys that you can ever comprehend or fathom. Amen and amen and amen. Let's pray together.